colleagues, please take your seats on the stage. Let's continue our work day in the Ukraine Crisis Media Center.
The topic of next press conference, presentation of the exhibition Shadows of Forgotten Ancestors. Speakers are Pavlo Gudimov, project curator, founder of the Argatoria Gallery, Andriy Alferov, project curator, film critic, Ivan Kozlenko, general director of Oleksandr Dovzhenko National Center, and Polina Tolmachova, FILM.UA Group, PR and marketing director. Good afternoon. I would like to say a few words about the exhibition, what it's all about, why we need that. You know, we do not know how to properly paint the fences into blue and the yellow color or to ruin the monuments to Lenin, but we could not pass by such a monumental work as the Shadows of Forgotten Ancestors, and to organize the exhibition, which would actually illustrate the chemistry of this movie. The idea developed last year in Paris in the Cinematheque in a very picturesque place, and Ivan Kozlenko joined me in our trip there, and we decided, after going to the exhibition of Michelangelo Antonioni, we decided, and we were approaching the jubilee of the movie Shadow of the Forgotten Ancestors, we should organize this exhibition. The backbone was created immediately, but now it's kind of the artistic, workshop, and despite the 50th anniversary, it's absolutely still a living creature, which actually casts the shadows not only in domestic movie makers, but also in the Western movies. So the concept of the exhibition is the artistic laboratory, try to demonstrate the roots of those such flowers as which are called the Shadows of the Forgotten Ancestors, and we are talking about the group of the like-minded persons, because in the time of the film was shot, it was kind of an adventure, even for those who were the creators of those, and that movie actually survived and its own period, epoch, and now remains to be one of the shadows which actually deserves some additional studies. We do not claim to the utmost truth. We could not even reach the bottom of this well, because this well is bottomless, but we carried out some kind of research, and we are going to share with you what we discovered for ourselves. And you'll be able to know about that on March 23rd, when you can go to this exhibition and see for yourselves. Now I'd like to turn the mic to Ivan Kozlovsky, because both of us, while in one of the cafeteria in Paris, we started to talk about that, and we invited Pavlo Gudimov and another partner of ours, this FILM.UA studio, who helped us a lot, because this exhibition is a multimedia one, and we couldn't do without the assistance of the FILM.UA, who also helped us with the new technologies and made it possible for everything to be conspicuous, to be actually brilliant, etc., etc. Ivan Kozlovsky, thank you. In fact, this is the exhibition, the idea of which was born, let's say, based on the Michelangelo Antonioni's exhibition. But first of all, it was very interesting to us how they worked in the Cinematheque with this material. We not only we watched or saw the movies or materials, we actually acquainted ourselves with the inspiration of that master, and we actually managed to reveal the dual bottom, so to say, of this Shadur, present this Antonioni's exhibition, where he actually decoded those color code, and the color code actually was one of the conceptual ideas which we tried to use and implement, realize during this exhibition. Also, very interesting was the Red Desert, that was the first color movie, and the way this genius director worked with the color when they actually had to paint the grass in order to achieve special tints and hues of the color. And we understood that maybe in the shadows of the forgotten ancestors, maybe the Parajanova also worked with those color game. You, by Parajanova, I mean that was also the first color film year. And this concept actually we carried not only to the exhibition proper, but for the preparation period of this exhibition. And Pavlo and all of us, we did a lot in order to rethink the experience associated with this movie. There is a need there to canonize this movie, because canonization of this material actually led to kind of ordinary perception of this movie. But now we again can see that this is not an ordinary movie. And we are talking about the change in our, there was a lot of different layers, political conception, etc., etc. Then we face another very important task, depersonalize to some extent this movie, because to some extent it has been associated with Parajanov, but this artistic laboratory and the concept, which say that was a co-authors efforts of many persons who have been forgotten. Many of those took innovations past to cooperate with the movie makers, and some of them actually were associated with this movie. For example, Kozlenko, she was actually terrified when she had the first time saw herself in that movie. Again, this is the rethinking of this movie material by the actors, by the creators, and thus the people who try to, let's say, to breathe in another new wind, so to say, into this movie, and then just to we have some kind of progress. But we try to remove that shell around that without actually denying that this one of the features of that movie, but we actually set ourselves a special task, and I hope that it has been translated successfully into life. I would like to turn the mic to Polina Tolmachova, who represents here FILM.UA Studio. But before doing that, I would say a few words. We actually called upon many influential people's institutions who actually entertained our proposal and said, yes, that is really very interesting, but they politely denied or refused and said, give us some time. But then they said that they didn't have any money, hinting that they did not believe us, but the FILM.UA Studio believed us, and I would like to specially emphasize the contribution of Zvigniewski, who created a new media field here in Ukraine. This is kind of the features of a new manager, which is not very popular here, when people do not love really like new something new. They would like to have whatever they used to have, and they do not want to talk about anything and the novelties, whatever. So we are really grateful to our co-organizer Sergei Sosnovsky, among those who actually believed us and helped us to realize our idea. Polina Tolmachova, thank you, Andriy. In fact, you said a lot already. I would like to answer the obvious question: why we, as a FILM.UA Studio, dealing with industrial movies, why we need all that? But when the Pavlo and Andriy approached us with this idea, we did not hesitate a single moment, because we decided immediately to take part, to participate in that, for a number of reasons. So one obvious reason is that this movie, The Shadows of Forgotten Ancestors, is the movie from capital letter, and we need a lot of such movies of this caliber here in Ukraine. The second reason being, as my colleagues already mentioned, is a multimedia exhibition inspired by the Antonioni's exhibition. We wanted to do something similar here, to bring the movie, to take it from the screen, to make it 3D and live. This is an original experimental platform. When you come to the exhibition site, you'll understand what I'm talking about, and maybe Pavel will tell you about this more a bit later. Reason number three maybe is a kind of very daring on my part to say that, but this is very important to our people, to our country, who find themselves today on the way of trying to find their own identity, their own significance in this life of ours. Very often answering our own question, who we are, what we are, why we are here, what for, etc. I believe that this exhibition will help a lot of us to find the answers to those questions. And if we have our identity, when we come to realize who we are, what we are, then our culture, and in particular our cinematography, will actually find a new development, because we are talking about something which is exists deep inside our souls. So that was a kind of romantic step when we embarked on that road. And while we are talking here, they take care in the Arsenal site to assemble all the necessary props there. So thank you very much for your attention. A few words about the exhibition proper. Now I would like to ask Vera Loy, who is also one of the administrators of that exhibition. You know, we are sitting, all of us are sitting here, just a few people here, but 45 people are involved in arranging this exhibition, plus 15 technicians, plus 20 volunteers. So you can imagine the scope of the work and the effort. Now we are going to demonstrate to you a short presentation consisting of several pages, just for you to have an idea what this exhibition is all about. We start everything with the zone of recreation or lobby, where the architect and the artist of the exhibition, Andriy Alferov, provided the complete design of that space, where we are going to stage the round tables, was an experimental gusul cuisine, our kitchen. We are going to have the lounge smelling of the hay and tree vegetation. So you can see that each audience, each hall, like each section of the movie, has its own name. Iwan already said a lot, Kozlenko, about the color. The first room is called is red. The red is the color of blood, it's the color of the authority, also very aggressive and absolutely beautiful color. It plays a specific role, a special role in the film. If we remember the red horses, or let's say the current horses, so that was the name of the exhibition in France. You see the four frames where the red color is dominating, the red horses, red blood, red forest, and the fantastic directors and the cameraman effort. The special scene in the tavern when Ivan is hit by an axe on his head, you know. Another, you can see the what he invented. He invented just the thought of purchasing the Hutsul hut or house, which actually were easy to buy today. They decide to buy it, to bring to the Kiev to Arsenal, then return back to its native nooks. So we already disassembled every detail, and this is actually the installation which represents everything which was specific with that house, that hut, and then the Kutovich says, "Listen, people, what I'm going to say. Not only was the genius illustrator, but he in his practice was the first design artist of that movie. The next room, I agree. Nobody can say that the ethnography is very important for this movie, critical importance. This not just the props. The Ilyanka, Yakutovich, and Parijanov, they love dearly the Carpathian region, their people, their traditions and habits. So it's not just the demonstration of ethnographic features, which you can see in any museum, but I would like to immediately say that our media is nothing, you know, new, the traditional media, but we are talking about music, let's say the mobile or moving pictures, modern and not so modern art. We are talking about the direct speech, because multimedia contains performance a hierarchy which actually takes roots from in the ethnography which we are going to have during the period of this exhibition. And we show the museum artifacts, for example, that kind of axe, which is the one of the heroes of that exhibition. Can see the special tiles with the shown depicting the those axes, the fighters and the axes, and the wooden Hutsu sculptures or figurines, which actually attracts me immensely as a curator. I understand the force of that naive expression, which actually leads the way ahead of time and space. Now, this is dedicated, this hall is dedicated to the author. Of course, somebody will just say that we did not say everything, but believe me, we didn't have enough time to find all the necessary materials, which actually our association was very important participants in this process. We concentrated our attention on Parajanov, on Ilyenko, on Yakutovich, and the design artists, and you'll see the Shiderer's masterpieces in the legendary things, which have never been seen by anybody. We are talking about the frame, this distribution or detail framing of Parajanov, which show you how the film was actually shot or made. We are talking about the realistic work done. And this is a great scope of the work. By the way, this was done by Lienka. Also, you can have can compare those. You can see the artistic mastership which was inherited in those works by Parajanov. He was a genius, an outstanding person. And somebody said that we personalized this exhibition, but it's impossible because Parajanov has such big impact on all the participants in the process, and the quotation from Kutors that everybody had a kind of the complex of incompetences compared to Parajanov. Sergei Kutovich, he helped us a lot if you're talking about providing materials for our display, materials for the exhibition. Of course, we're talking about the Dovzhenko studio, but Sergei Kutovich actually managed to preserve maybe the minor details, but the major phrase of the exhibition is the quotation of his: everything has been stolen, nothing remained. In other words, the phrase which pertains, yeah, by the way, those are the works of Parajanov. And this phrase actually can be associated not only with this movie. What else is important to say, that some of the thing which may actually hit on the strings of your heart. In each room, the music which actually sounds in this area before our briefing started, this was composed by Svetlana Vinyov, composer, absolutely talented composer who has a special feeling, sense of the movie, of the volume, of the scope, of the space, and a curator. I cannot imagine how all those things can be can find the one show, one person. Well, everything is based on the instant graphic music, electronic music, and original soundtrack from the movie. Next one. Amor Sacro e Amor Profano. I actually wanted to go and then to see this Tizian, Tiziano's work in Rome. I actually found 3 days and went to Rome to watch with our own eyes. We didn't have an access to the Villa Borghese where this picture is on display, but I could understand why Parajanov was inspired by this work. Love, heavenly love, and the earthly love united in one picture. The whole room, this is a kind of the unveiled scene of a wedding party. And Andriy came up with very interesting proposals to the directors and the artists to make two remakes. One of the Kirill Serebrennikov and the Igor Padalchuk. And you'll see those remakes in that room. Also, we could see the yoke, original yoke, in this, which was used for this movie and still has been preserved. And I might say that not everything has been stolen, far from that, you know. And there is such a language, such media, which is called comics. It so happened that in Ukraine this tradition is only in the beginning of the road. In some of the books, special editions are being published. And Boris Filonenko and his friends just decided to create a comic book. But this is not a comic dedicated to the movie or the Kotsubinsky novel. It tells the stories and legends which surrounded that film or that movie. If you would like to have the kind, this kind of a present, we have some of the copies at the exit of this room. This is a very unique supplementary material to this exhibition, and which actually is talking about some new media. Well, this is not the movie or the frames from the movie. Those are the legends which surround this movie. 18 stories which document, which have been confirmed or not confirmed by documents, but sometimes they were. So next room, which introduces the context of those days, when you can see the central timeline, 1962-64, and we associate those events which took place in those days in the cinematography, in the politics, etc. And understand that any reasonable person can understand when we have this kind of transition from, let's say, the creativity to the rather complex period of time, because there was that time was associated with a change of the authority. Khrushchev left his position, or they made him leave, and it signaled the epoch of Brezhnev. One Ukraine was replaced by another one, but was nothing good was associated with that. For many days, for many years, all the documents associated with Parajanov's name and his mom were considered to be classified in the, by the SBU and the former KGB. But those documents actually confirm all the stories associated with that movie, that everywhere. There were some persons who actually were listened and taking notes about what has been said or shown about the red fascism or whatever, who is going to go abroad. Everything was in the form of the reports or some informants' notes. And they actually unclassified this document about the first night of this movie signed by the KGB man. What was the role played by Stus, by Chernobyl? A special report was dedicated just for to Stus. Everything was actually eyed by the competent bodies, as we say. And if you're talking about the 1st of September 1964, this is the day when this movie saw the or the first night. Actually, this this original ticket 50 years later with the original signature of the participants of the actors in that movie, actually. This is the modern artist Sergei Panasonic, this kind of the props, a broken cross. And the last room, which we call the multi-dot one, actually, this person mentioned the comics. Unbelievable figurines and sculptures of Mykola Malichka, the series of 10 figures, which actually part of this project, and the frames from the movie, static and dynamic. I believe it exhausts my story about the exhibition. Maybe I told you more than enough, but perhaps I will do whatever I cannot but do. First of all, I would like to thank all my colleagues, especially the FILM.UA studio, which shouldered all the financial risks. This is not just a risk. We are talking about the torrents, which is cannot be understood by the majority of businessmen. So in your handouts, you all have a booklet associated with the project, but this is a booklet, this is not a catalog of the project. Catalogue has 500 pages. It's still being printed. And this is a story about Hoots rules, where the long livers is compared to our big city dwellers. You know, this proposal, this was the proposal of one of our designers to use such colors for the cover sheets. And whenever it's is going to dull you or not, I'm going to name all of them. Well, I'm not going to give the names of all the 60 persons. We understand that we won't be able to do it. Two of us, and we actually spent our code, we the four major participants in this project, FILM.UA Group, Center of Arsenal, and the charitable fund of Boris Loshkin, who helped us a lot. Specifically, we're talking about the archives of the SBU. This will last from March 23 to April 10, through April 10, in which small time you can see the list of the institutions, our participants and partners. And in order to be, just to pay homage to everybody and to give merit to everybody, National Artistic Museum of Ukraine, National Museum and Lviv, National Museum of Svaty Kobrinsky about Gutsulshina, Gutsul area, and Pakutia. National Center for Culture, Sergei Parajan Museum in Yerevan, and the director is going to attend this exhibition. Museum Hanta Grazda, National Union of Artists of Ukraine, National Kozlenko Dovzhenko Film Studio, which actually produced that movie back in 1964, National Center by name of Oleksandr Dovzhenko, and great assistance was provided by the trailblazers, who in majority of cases are a bit forgotten. National Agency of Ukraine on the Cinematography, the Archive of Literature and Arts, the Archives of Security Service of Ukraine, Ministry of Culture of Ukraine, private collections and the archives. Also, I would like to thank everybody, and perhaps I will not abuse your time and attention, but maybe you have questions, and it would be our pleasure to take those. Thank you, Pavel. Thank you, colleagues. Should you have any questions or clarifications, please introduce yourself. Larry Madrak, legal media expert. I don't know what Antonio inspired you with, but it seems to me that you, like nobody else, are reading the requirements of this space. Again, we are talking about some kind of open, independent path, which this movie actually trailblazed in those days in 1964. Now you're actually, again, open the space of the future. This is not just an artistic endeavor, it is something more than that. 1 month ago, I was talking with Pavlo Gudimov about this art project he was working on already then. I became very much interested in the quotation which he showed to me, and actually this is enclosed in the booklet, one of the booklets, you know, that the capital of the former powerful Soviet Union, a thousand-year-old city, had to preserve the space in order to make this city the city museum, the city of great symbolism, development of the thousand upon thousand-year nation. I believe you're trying to do that with your exhibition, but today from this place I could see the components, elements, and participants of that exhibition. What other components or constituent parts can you talk about? I'm talking about the constituent parts of the exhibition. I'll start to answer your question. Andriy will maybe follow me. The same was said by Sergei Kutovich. Unbelievable, incredible love towards this material, to Carpathians, to the art, to the arts, to those who, despite the fact that it was really difficult, did not notice that was difficult. I mean, I was driven as a curator by my feelings. I have a feeling that I became a kind of close relative to those people. I've become a relative to my colleagues for a long time now. We are very close people here. But you understand, the thing is, we aren't talking about the exhibition today. Indeed, we work a bit in different way, with a more wide understanding of the space, wider than just the space of the artistic arsenal. We're dealing with a space which could be called a new intelligentsia, new group of intellectuals, or reattribution of some of the cultural elements, which is absolutely a badly required thing today when we face kind of cultural-less vandalism, which we call today the post-Soviet period. This proves once again, and very specifically, that in those very difficult period, they could create some genius pieces of art. We did that. We are going to continue to develop those that heritage which we inherited from our ancestors. Well, I would also to think in the context of this wide notion as love. You know, it's like dealing with a human being. You do not cry out at every corner, "I love her," or "I love him." You just want to be with this person. The same with holds with this material. It's kind of our confession. This is our love. We do not know how to paint the fences in national colors or do something public like that, but we actually fell in love with this material and those people involved in that movie. We actually felt we were sorry that we were not born earlier and did not live in those days where, like, Sergei Kutovich and other people who could join Parajanov in the shooting range in the film shooting area in Kyiv. And if you're talking about the, there was a day, let's say, 1960s when was the the hippie movement was in its prime, you know, and everybody said, "Let's join Parajanov," and had some good time there. So that was kind of intertwining, or let's say the fusion of different energy which you could feel with your skin. And now when you study or investigate this material, and everybody, they experience like some pain or in the back of the head, and the desire to leap to the ceiling, you know, when we unveiled a new another curtain. And despite the what we have, the kind of relationship between Ukraine and Russia, but they managed to find the Russian actor Yukhtin, who was the first to play the title role, but then they found the Mikolaychuk, or we found the actress Bestaeva. She was forgotten. And they were talking about this movie in the political context, and some kind of political platform for dissidence, for the different minded person, but they did not talk about this movie as a platform of beauty, because the Parajan was a singer of beauty, and then this movie was spreading all over the world like cancer, malignant tumor, you know, in a good sense of tumor, of course, but you know, it was so much dear to all of us. We have kind of aftertaste tomorrow. The exhibition is already in our hands and is going to be opened the other day in the Arsenal Gallery. But actually, we really wish to infect everybody with this kind of virus of love to this kind of art. Also, would like to say that in addition to those emotional wording, I would like to say that this exhibition is another road back home, like it was to many people who were involved in making that movie. Many of those people were just urban citizens who had never encountered this kind of the culture, and many of them fell immediately in love, and they actually acquainted themselves with the, in broad sense, the national categories. There was, to many of us, that was a road back home, but in a wider or the broader sense, then back to the hood soul area, back to home, where we have a place, a special room for the Armenian Parajanov to the Russian, ethnic Russian Bestaeva. And the number of other people who created Ukrainian culture, which doesn't have to be based on the purely ethnic foundations. And I'm talking that many people fell in love with this culture who were actually brought up on this culture. In a broad sense, this road back home must become the road back home for many visitors to these exhibitions. We are not ashamed to consider this platform our dear home. It's very easy to associate oneself with this home because we are talking about modern language, modern categories, and Pavel was right to say that it's a kind of attribution, a new, let's say, a reading of this material, but this actually requires actualization. And this actualization, we have to find the proper key to this actualization. But this movie is so charismatic that it in itself gives birth to a big number of the peripheral ideas or senses or meanings, semantics, we will, because in some kind it's a political Bible for the second half of the 20th century. Well, I believe actually was a little bit everything, you know. I was listening to you, so I said, yes, mentally. So love, and please come to our exhibition. Next question, please. Let's say it's Jack, the museum space. First of all, I would like to thank you, because the projects which you take care of, you, Andriy, and you, Ivan, and those projects are such a high level. You infect the society with those. I'm very much inspired sitting here, and I believe that this atmosphere is sensed by everybody present here. So thank you very much for the huge work you have been doing for almost a year. I have a very narrow, maybe very simple question, but since I represent here a very narrow professional publication, what museum and this place were involved in this exhibition, and are you happy with your cooperation with the Museum of Ukraine? I'm going to tell about just one exhibit, maybe my colleagues will add to that, when we were talking about presentation of ethnography. I personally love immensely the Museum of Gutsul people in Pakutia. And those who have not yet visited that museum, I strongly advise you to do that. As one of the former curators of that museum used to say, Parijano, when we visited that museum, said that that was his favorite museum. And in that museum, there is one masterpiece, which are just a few all over the place. You know, Danilo Kaluk's Swolog, Gutsul Hat. Whether he is the author, or maybe this is kind of coincidence, he resided there and made the thing. This is a proof of the Kotsubinsky words that pagan traditions were just put in the clothes of Christianity. They used the mermaid and the church with the crosses and the cathedral. But this in itself is so so conspicuous or multi-message one. And I would like to bring that kind of work, which is actually canvas, to bring to Kiev. Lesa knows she works in the museum. No, it's impossible to bring it here because this is on the constant display. Actually, we tried to do that, and we met with Dina several times. But in the end, the director of that museum said, "Okay, if you wish so much to do that, we will allow you to bring it back to take it to Kiev." It's a big canvas, a big picture. I mean, the textile picture. 3x4 meters, something like that. But you know, it's something which inspired Parajanov. If you can imagine, I think we can, how he was inspired by those Hutsul associated things like icons or sculptures or this kind of swallow. It's not just the It's not just the beam which supports the roofing structure. This is one of the things. When, for example, this beam was taken by Hutsul, if they moved to another building, we start to build. That is kind of the soul and heart of the, for the Hutsul. You know, something, if you take it away or forget about that, then this, conventional speaking, this building of the nation will just collapse without that beam. And I know that actually some of the people are waiting at the end of this conference to interview you further on. So one more question and we are going to close this press conference. Actually, very short question. Do you plan a kind of press tour for journalists before actually the opening ceremony? And when? Yes, we plan that. A special tour for journalists before we open this museum. It's going to take place on March 23 on 6 p.m. At 6 p.m. So one comment more. One thing which I didn't plan to say, to mention here. In some sense, this is, a, you know, by chance or not, but it's being housed by the artistic arsenal. And but unfortunately, we have some bitter thing to add. Maybe this exhibition will become the last in a number of the successful projects of the artistic arsenal, which is associated with the end of the contract of Natalia Zabolotna and those real subversive conditions which on the part of the state management of the service, you know, to put the end of such, to such projects. So I would like to ask Pavlo to approach again the administration, presidential administration, and to do something in order to make this competition open. Nobody is talking about an automatic nomination or director. It should be maybe go through transparent and open procedure. I mean this kind of competition or contest in a very democratic way by the commission, which has to, the members of which have to represent the community and not the officials. A very good proposal, and we would like to thank the artistic arsenal not only for the walls or for the space, but also for the spirit which reigns there. And there's a very good example when the pieces of culture take the their legitimate place in a very legitimate manner. So I think everybody will try to do everything possible, everything which depends on us, in order for the Zabolotna be re-elected and continue to take care of a very important project which unite on this territory many different players. Also, we forgot to mention the following. First of all, I would like to thank the UCMC, within the premises of which, actually, which houses this press briefing, who support us a lot, who communicate with the authorities and do that very efficiently. Even the Ukrainian Crisis Media Center helped us or assist us with publication of those booklets, which has nothing to do with their direct duties, but that's what partnership means. So this is a project which involves many different participants. So let's perhaps switch over to the personal interviews. And again, a lot of thanks for your patience, for your attention paid to us, and to the fact that you're writing about culture. Thank you.